Our distinguished speaker, Prime Minister of Singapore, Mr. Lee Hsien Loong, excellencies, ministers and members of parliament, Chancellor of SMU, Mr. Yong Pung Hao, members of the Singapore Management University Board of Trustees, members of the faculty and staff and students of SMU, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure on the milestone 15th anniversary of SMU's founding to welcome Prime Minister Mr. Lee Hsien Loong to deliver the 7th SMU Ho Rih Hwa Leadership in Asia public lecture. The Ho Rih Hwa Leadership in Asia public lecture series was established by my mother, Mrs. Ho Lien Fung, in memory of my father, Mr. Ho Rih Hwa, a former Singapore ambassador and businessman. She hoped it would inspire students and the public by giving them the opportunity to hear accomplished entrepreneurs, business leaders, and political figures from the Asia-Pacific region and beyond to share their experiences, insights, and opinions. This lecture series featured as its inaugural speaker, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, and subsequently other leaders such as Mr. Mahathir Mohamad of Malaysia, Aung San Suu Kyi of Burma, Benigno Aquino of the Philippines, Mr. F.W. de Klerk of South Africa, and others. I was particularly touched by Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's unhesitating acceptance to be the inaugural speaker for this series way back in 2002. He explained in his address that it was because he felt obliged to people like my parents, members of the pioneer generation, who stepped forward to contribute in any little way they could at the birth of this nation. My father was a businessman and never a professional diplomat, but at a time when Singapore had no foreign service to speak of whatsoever, he took up the challenge and became Singapore's first ambassador to Thailand and subsequently to Germany and the European Union. At the same time, many other members of the pioneer generation rallied to Mr. Lee Kuan Yew's inspirational leadership because they bonded with his vision for this improbable nation. The Singapore of today and tomorrow barely resembles that of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew or my parents 50 years ago. But although manifested in different ways, the challenges as well as the promises remain fundamentally unchanging and constant. New leaders, however, need to bond with their people in new ways. And it has been encouraging and inspirational for all of us to see how Mr. Lee Hsien Loong has touched the hearts of many young Singaporeans, including the millennials. Mr. Lee Hsien Loong studied at the University of Cambridge, graduating with a first-class honors in mathematics and a diploma in computer science with distinction. He subsequently earned a master's in public administration from the Harvard Kennedy School. Mr. Lee was first elected as an MP in 1984 and has been re-elected 6 times. In 1986, he was elected to the Central Executive Committee of the People's Action Party and became its Secretary General in 2004. Prior to that, he had served in the Ministry of Trade and Industry and Ministry of Defense. He was Minister of Finance, Chairman of the Monetary Authority of Singapore, and Deputy Prime Minister. He became Singapore's 3rd Prime Minister in 2004 and remains so today. It was as Prime Minister that Mr. Lee Hsien Loong graced SMU as our guest of honor at the opening of our city campus in 2006. This is a momentous year for SMU and for Singapore as we celebrate the university's 15th anniversary and Singapore celebrates its 50th year of independence. Both of these anniversaries have given us cause to look at our past, to see how far we have come, to appreciate all that we have today, and to look forward to everything that we aspire to achieve in the future. As a nation, we've given thanks to the pioneer generation, the generation of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew and my parents, who turned improbable survival into a prosperous success that is recognized the world over. It is also, sadly, a year in which we mourned as a university and as a nation the loss of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. The outpouring of grief and expressions of gratitude at SMU reflected those of the citizens and residents of Singapore and many, many others in the region and around the world. In that inaugural Ho Rih Hwa Leadership in Asia public lecture 13 years ago, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew identified the Frontier Society of the United States as especially conducive to entrepreneurship. He cited four contributing characteristics. First, a national emphasis on personal independence and self-reliance. Second, respect for those starting new businesses. Third, acceptance of failure in entrepreneurial efforts. And lastly, tolerance for a high degree of income disparity if necessary. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew called for a change of culture, values, and mindset towards encouraging more entrepreneurs. He believed that while entrepreneurship is latent in Singapore, it is not extinct, and the key to unlocking this latent potential lies in the education and engagement of our youth. Mr. Lee Hsien Loong, in the spirit of SG50 and SMU 15 celebrations, would take a more holistic and entirely 360-degree view in his lecture entitled Singapore, the Past, the Present, and the Future. Singapore is at an inflection point, economically, socially, and politically. We're entering a period of relatively slower growth, just as our regional neighbors approach similar levels of economic and infrastructural development. Singapore's millennial generation now has a different set of expectations and values to those that have gone before. And politically, the PAP is looking hard at the process of leadership succession and navigating through the uncertainties of a much more diverse society, as well as a politically more involved and demanding electorate. We are indeed lucky to have Mr. Lee Hsien Loong as a prime minister whose popularity resonates with the young as much as those from his present generation. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a very warm welcome to Prime Minister of Singapore, Mr. Lee Hsien Loong.
Mr. Yong Pang Hao, Chancellor of SMU, Mr. Ho Kwong Ping, Chairman of SMU, Professor Arnold De Meyer, President, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to be here today to join you all for the Ho Rih Hwa Leadership in Asia public lecture. When we separated from Malaysia and became independent 50 years ago, our challenges seemed all-encompassing and insuperable. There were so many desperately urgent priorities: growing the economy, building the SAF, education, healthcare, housing. Everything was critical, and our survival was at stake. One important new area which we needed to master quickly was diplomacy, to stake out our place in the world and defend it. And we had no experienced diplomats, so we call on businessmen, on senior bureaucrats, on academics, even on politicians to help. And Mr. Ho Rih Hwa answered this call. He wasn't born a diplomat, he was the son of an immigrant, a successful entrepreneur, and a prominent businessman. But he served with distinction as our ambassador in Thailand, in Belgium, at the European Economic Community, as it then was, and also at the UN in Geneva. And he refused to accept any remuneration because he saw this as a national service, a duty that he was honored to discharge. Pioneers like Mr. Ho Rih Hwa saw the urgency and the enormity of the challenges that we face. But instead of running away, they threw in their lot and they gave it their best shot. And with their help, Singapore overcame the challenges and thrived. And that's why today we honor the pioneer generation. Because we today are the beneficiaries of their sacrifices. So it's fitting that 50 years on at this lecture, named in Mr. Ho Rih Hwa's honor, we discuss the critical challenges that we face for the next 50 years and ask ourselves, what should we do? Challenge ourselves, what should we do? What challenges do we face today? Well, it depends on the time frame that you look at it. If you take a 10-year perspective, I would say the first challenge is the economy. We've reached a high level in terms of GDP. Our per capita GDP is as high as Japan. But we have to find a way to continue to grow in order that we can improve our people's lives, because our workers aspire to earn higher wages. So our economy needs to create more and better jobs. And collectively, we've got to perform at a higher level, more efficient, more productive, more rewarding for our people. And we're not quite there yet. And yet, having reached this high level, there's no ready model anywhere in the world that we can simply say, ah, that's what I want to be, follow that, do that, and get there. If we can continue upgrading ourselves over the next decade, in 10 years, I think we'll be in a different league. Then we have the resources, we can make the investments in our people, we can afford the social safety nets, we can improve all our lives. But if we can't make this breakthrough, if we've reached a ceiling and stagnate and lose ground, then we will go through what other countries who have hit such a ceiling are going through now and struggling with. Taiwan, Korea, even Japan, trying their best to find a new way forward. And if we are stuck for a decade, at the end of that, we will face not just economic problems, but even social problems, because there'll be unemployment, young people will be unable to find jobs. Instead of hope, we will have restlessness. So on a 10-year view, I would say we focus on the economy. On a 25-year view, I say we focus on population. Population issues come to the fore. Because the economy can go up, the economy can go down, but in the long run, demography is destiny. And 25 years is long enough for our birth trends and our marriage and parenthood policies to take root and to have an impact. It's a generation, or nowadays almost a generation. It's old and long enough for this generation of students to graduate, get married, have children, and turn up at commencement when your children graduate. Now, over 25 years, demography makes a difference. A TFR of total fertility rate of 1.2, where we are today, compared to a fertility rate of 1.5, which is where we would like to be. In 1 year, that's a difference of 9,000 babies. But over 25 years, that's more than 200,000 new people, more babies born. And it can make all the difference to a population. Because if we can get our fertility rate up to 1.5, of course I'd like to go higher, but let's get to 1.5 first. Then we can keep our population younger and more vibrant. But if the TFR stays at 1.2, then I think that's going to be much harder, even with immigration, to have a young and a vibrant population. A shrinking society will be an aging society. And an aging society will cause profound problems. Our economy will be stagnant or declining. The whole tone of the society, instead of being young and forward-looking, will be pessimistic, oriented to the status quo, or even looking towards a glorious past. And I think that's a sad place to be in. So, 10 years, the economy, 25 years, demography, population, but 50 years, I would say, identity counts. That's the most profound challenge we have. The fundamental reason we've succeeded over the last 50 years is not just because we've had good policies. Yes, we have good policies, but the policies have worked because the population have supported these policies, which could therefore be implemented and could therefore produce results for Singapore. And that depended most fundamentally on our collective will to succeed and on the sense that we were building a nation together. Over the 50 years, we've experienced national crisis from time to time, starting with independence, separation, when our backs were to the wall. But each time we overcame a crisis, we proved our mettle, and in the process deepened our shared experience and our Singapore identity. And so we got here because of the will, because of that passion, because of the commitment to Singapore. And over the next 50 years, we'll need good policies, but just like for the last 50 years, for these policies to succeed, we need a strong sense of identity and of nationhood. We need to be proud to be Singaporeans. We need to want Singapore to be special, to make Singapore special. And if we have that fundamental conviction and motivation, then we can make everything else work. Then we can overcome all our challenges. Now, let me talk about it in a bit more detail, one by one, starting with 10 years, the economy. We are in a good position today because we've been growing for the past 50 years. And if you look back to 1965, over 50 years, our economy has actually grown more than 40 times in size since independence. It's the most impressive curve. And that's real terms, real GDP, discounting inflation. If you look at it per capita, our GDP has gone up per capita 13 times. And the growth has been sustained. Year by year, we've had good growth. You look at it over the last 50 years, we've enjoyed, starting from a minus position when we were in Malaysia, we got out, we made very high growth, and year by year, we've sustained that until now. We feel it in our lives, because our children live better lives than ourselves. They are born into homes that are better than the homes which we lived in. They face less risk in life. They have more choices of jobs than their parents or their grandparents. I know sometimes young people feel pressured and look at the future and say life is tough, but I assure you, 50 years ago, life was tougher. And because we've made this progress for 50 years economically, so this year we have good reason to celebrate SG50 and to give thanks for our journey from the third world to the first. So we've had high growth, one of the fastest in the world. But if you look at it over the longer term, from here down, gradually the growth has been slowing because as we have matured, as our economy has reached more of its limits and taken up the slack, it's a natural process. So if we look at it decade by decade rather than year by year, you can see how each decade, the growth has been a little bit slower, except here, but generally the trend is decade by decade, we've been slowing down. And as we mature, our base gets bigger. Every incremental step is harder work. And all countries experience this. Even China is starting to see this happening now. So how do we get that growth? If you break it down, the economy grows by two ways. First, either you get productivity, you do better and perform better, or second, you get a workforce growth. You expand, more bodies, more workers, therefore it's larger. And it's very illuminating to look and see how much of our growth came from workforce and how much of our growth came from productivity. We don't have numbers all the way back to 1965, but if you look at the last three decades, you can see that about half came from workforce growth and about half came from productivity growth. In the last decade, not quite so good, but overall, that's roughly the picture. Now, we've been able to grow our workforce because we've had young population. After the war, baby boomers were born, they came of age, they entered the workforce, and they became productive. And as the baby boomers grew older, they're now about my age or a little bit younger and starting to retire, we topped up with foreign workers and boosted our workforce, and so we've kept our economy growing. In this most recent decade, the productivity growth has come down. This has been a very unstable decade because we've had the global financial crisis, we had many uncertainties in the world, but we managed to grow with our own population, topped up with foreign workers, and therefore we could keep the economy going. And it's just as well we did this, because if we hadn't done this, and we had gone into the global financial crisis and shrunk, like many other countries did, then I think we could have had many companies closing down or maybe leaving and going somewhere else and causing job losses for Singaporeans. And I don't think we would have been able to weather the financial crisis with low unemployment, bounce back the following year, and see our lives improve as rapidly as they have done. And yet, there are limits, and we can't keep on increasing and bringing in foreign workers at a high rate just to maintain growth. And I fully understand Singaporeans who are anxious about the influx of foreign workers, about the impact on housing, about the impact on public transport, the competition for jobs. And so that's why we've slowed down the inflow and accepted the trade-off. And the trade-off is a slower, not quite so vibrant economy. But while we slow down, we have to do it in a measured and a balanced way, because you don't want to overdo the medicine, you don't want to cause our companies to shut down, particularly you don't want to cause hardship to our SMEs, which employ many Singaporeans, and we don't want to cause our own workers to lose their jobs. So this is where we have come so far, but what can we expect if you look ahead? And as far as we can tell, if you look ahead and look at this trend as well as what we are able to generate, I think a realistic estimate for our GDP growth is something like 2 to 4%, like this. Not as high as before, but not bad for where we are. And half of that comes from employment increase, and half of that comes from productivity increase. Now, are we certain? No. What do we know? Some of this we know for sure. I think the workforce numbers we have a good feel for, because we know how many Singaporeans there are. We know how many young people have been born and will be ready to work in the next 10 years. And even if this year I have a bonanza baby boom, they are not going to enter my workforce in the next 10 years. So the workforce numbers, I'm pretty sure, yeah, it's not going to exceed 2%, because the local numbers, we can tell, the foreign numbers, we have cut back, and I think we have to maintain our foreign worker policies. We cannot let that balloon out. And that means if we are going to get to what we want to be, which is 4% growth, we need to produce 2% in terms of productivity. And that's not an easy task. Many developed countries have tried to do this. It's a conundrum. They're all facing this difficulty. Productivity is hard to raise, and particularly since the global financial crisis, it has stagnated, and many countries are facing problems. And we too, over the last few years, have not achieved 2% growth. It's a hard slog because it requires a transformation of the society, of our economy, of businesses. You have to do things in different ways. You need new companies to come in in order to take over from old companies. There's turnover, there's churn, there's uncertainty, and then only can there be progress. And you have to keep on at it. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew used to quote the president of the Japanese Productivity Center, Mr. Goshi. Mr. Goshi lived to a ripe old age, and he was a real productivity advocate, passionate. And Goshi used to say that productivity requires a transformation of mankind's thinking, and it's a marathon without a finish line. So we have a difficult task cut out for us, but we have no choice. Because bigger countries, if you don't perform so well, you have the hinterlands, you have resources in the ground, you can survive. We don't have anything but ourselves. I have just been hosting Prime Minister Tony Abbott from Australia, and he was telling me how, when we became independent, Australia's per capita income was several times ours, and now we are, I think, double theirs. I said, that may be true, but you have uranium, you have gas, you have opals, you have gold, you have land. I have nothing. Just my people and the sweat of our brow. And that is what we have to do. So to go forward, we've got to improve our productivity and maintain our growth, because only then can we have good jobs and new opportunities for our people. It will be difficult because there'll be upheavals, there'll be changes, there'll be uncertainties, angst. But if you want to progress, that's the only direction to go. And that is something you must do across the board in many industries. Productivity is a very difficult idea to get across because it's abstract. It's a very difficult thing to grasp. You know in principle what number you want, but it's not quite clear what thing you must do. So let me give you a specific example. Let me use our port as an example, PSA. I just went to PSA last week. They opened two new terminals at Pasir Panjang, terminals 3 and 4. They are container terminals. And the container terminals, the container yards, have got cranes which carry the containers like this. This is at the old yard, but it's what you have. And you have container cranes, and they're operated by people who used to sit in the little cabins on top of each container crane, moving containers up across onto the truck, up from the truck across onto the stack, back and forth. One crane, one operator, squat on top. If you want to go to the loo, you stop the crane, you come down, you run a long way. Or you bring a plastic bag. That's what they do. Now, PSA uses automated rail gantry cranes in their container yards. Nobody sits up there anymore. They got TV cameras up there, they got computer controls up there. They got the controllers sitting in an office, air conditioned, managing several cranes at once. One controller, 5 cranes. And here is a picture of me trying to do just one crane from the office. And it's automated, there's computer vision, the computer handles most of it. If it finds something out of line beyond its tolerance, it will stop. The operator intervenes, puts things right, which happens about half the time. So one operator, 5 cranes. And the rest of the time, the cranes work automatically. So productivity per operator has gone up. One operator, 1 crane, now one operator, 5 cranes. And he only has to intervene half the time, and the technology can only improve. That is the way PSA has gone. Has it got to do that? Does it have a choice? It has no choice. Because PSA only has a living as long as it's more efficient than everybody else. Otherwise, the shipping lines won't bring their containers here, won't bring their businesses here. PSA will be out of business. 100,000 Singaporeans in PSA and in the maritime industry will be out of jobs. If PSA doesn't upgrade and do this, their competitors will. Tanjung Pelapas, visible just across the water. Hong Kong, Shekou in China, or Shanghai, which is already the busiest container port in the world. And these competitors have bigger hinterlands, cheaper workforce, more resources. And if they win over PSA's business, we've lost our cheese and our lunch. But then, if PSA does automate, what happens to the workers? Well, if we can grow our business, same number of workers do twice as much, three or four times as much business as before, well, business will go up, wages will go up. But if we can't grow our business, if there's no growth, then one operator to one crane, now one to five, that means four operators are going to be redundant. And that's going to be a tough spot to be. So when we go for productivity, it's both an opportunity and also a challenge. This is a technical job. But the same story of technology displacing jobs and creating new jobs is happening even to white-collar workers. Take, for example, the finance industry, where computer programs and apps are taking over the role of loan officers in assessing loans and creditworthiness. You don't depend so much on your officer talking to the person, assessing him, trying to figure out whether he's reliable, whether he's responsible, whether he'll pay back your loan. You go for big data. Find out who his friends are, find out what his lifestyle is, find out what his spending pattern is, and then you correlate that with lots of other people who have similar patterns, and you say, is he going to pay me back or not? And the computer will tell you more reliably than the loan officer. Loan officer has to generate a new job for himself, or he's in trouble. So many existing jobs are going to be upended this way. If you are a doctor, some of your diagnosis may be done by a big blue computer. If you are an engineer, many of your calculations are already done by computer systems. If you are a pilot, a lot of your flying is done by the aeroplane. So some people think half of existing jobs may be taken over by computers in one way or another over the next 20 years and will change. And I would say even if you are a lawyer, a lot of your work will change because the business of looking up the statutes, the business of researching the documents, of finding relevant references, of highlighting and underlining all the bits which tell in your favor and against you, computers can do that quite well, and they don't get tired. I think making speeches, they'll take a bit longer, but it's a serious message. We have to stay ahead of the curve, prepare our workers and businesses for the future economy. And that's why we've launched Skills Future as a national movement. It will play a critical role to help Singaporeans become resilient and adaptable. It will make sure, if you play your part, that our people will always have the opportunities to develop to the fullest with training available at every stage of your lives. Because as your jobs change, your skill sets need to change, and you cannot depend on what you learned longer and longer ago in the past as you grow older. You have to learn new skills, and you have to be able to do new jobs. And then when the world changes, we are prepared, and we are able to change with it. So this is a transformation of the society, a transformation in the way we learn, in the way we work, in the way we value individuals for what you do, what you contribute. And we must work at this because that is the way to make progress on productivity. That's the way to grow the economy. And that's the way, really, most fundamentally, so that every worker can feel proud of themselves and our society can be one where everybody has a valued place. So, 10 years, I think, the economy is a big problem. If we take a 25-year view, then I would say the key challenge for us is our population. Because demography, the population profile, has a profound impact on every aspect of our lives, on our economy, on our society, on our security. For the last 50 years, the demographics have been favorable. We had a post-war baby boom. Fortunately, we were able to educate the babies which were born after the war, create jobs for them, and make them valuable assets contributing to Singapore. If we hadn't done that, then instead of having a prosperous Singapore, you would have had migrant workers abroad working in tough jobs, low wages, but they go and they take that hardship because the alternative of staying at home is even worse. And that is what you see why we have migrant workers working in Singapore. They do tough jobs, and they are willing to do the tough jobs because the alternative for them, staying at home, is even tougher. But we avoided that. We got into a virtuous circle so that we could grow our economy, build up our resources, and invest in our basic needs, in healthcare, in education, in housing, in defense. And so we grew our economy and our population. And over 50 years, the population went up from 1.9 million at independence to where it is today, which is 5.5 million people. But as our standards of living went up and people grew more affluent, our fertility fell. Families had fewer babies. And the fertility rate fell, first of all, for those who were better educated, and then by the late 1970s, early 80s, 30 plus years ago, for the population as a whole. And 30 years ago, we had already concluded we had a problem, and we had to start to give Singaporeans incentives and support to have more children. Before that, we had to restrain families from having more children than they could take care of. But it changed, and we had to say, here, have this, have more children if you can afford it. But despite all our incentives, despite all our encouragements, despite all the speeches we made, National Day or no National Day, the TFR continued to come down. And now, as the baby boomers are not babies anymore, but in their 50s and 60s and aging, we are experiencing a major demographic shift. The population growth is slowing down. You look at it over the last 10 years, it was up, it's come down. A lot of this was by immigration, but where we are now, our population now is growing the slowest that it has done over the last 10 years. Last year, only 1.3%. But what is growing is the number of not so young people, and specifically the people aged 65 and above, those who are retiring and entering their golden years. This is what the engineers and mathematicians will call an exponential curve. 15 years ago, 2000, there were 220,000 people aged 65 and above retired. Today, it's double, 440,000. In another 15 years, it will double again, and we'll have 900,000 people aged 65 and above. Think about it. Everywhere you go, it will be like Japan today. You will see people, and you will see people with silver hair. And that's old people. But if you look at the younger people, their numbers are not going to grow. In fact, if you look at the people who are working age, our population of working age citizens has already peaked. It's quite scary. 10 years ago, we had 1.9 million who were aged either between 20 to 64. We are now at 2.2 million, and that's the peak, and we are coming gradually down. 10 years, 15 years from now, we are going to be back where we were 15 years ago. One big cycle, go up a bit, back down a bit. But you are not quite back where you were because 15 years ago, you only had 220,000 old people to look after. In other words, 8 working people supporting 1 old man or lady. Today, the ratio is 5-1. 15 years from now, we are back to 1.9 million working people, but by then, 2 working persons will be supporting 1 old man or woman. Think about it. So, you can see that in our population pyramid too. This is where we are today. The young, the men are the blue, the females are the pink. Usually, if you have a pyramid, the base should be bigger than the top. In our pyramid, the middle is fatter than the bottom. And the middle means the people who are here, the baby boomers, 50, 60, 65. These are the group now beginning to retire. Amongst the younger population, you see a small echo of the baby boomers here who were born to these parents. But after that, the numbers are down. That's today, aging, and quite a big group, 1 in 5 above 65 years old. But if you project forward and take it, say, till 2050, we will have this shape. With today's fertility, with today's immigration, we will be even more inverted, still with the biggest group here, and with the younger groups, smaller and smaller. It's something to worry about, because what does rapid aging mean for a nation? We are going to be growing older faster than nearly any other society in the world. I ask you, taxes. With this picture, with that graph, who is going to pay the taxes to spend on whom? 2 working persons, 1 retired citizen. The economy, how do we stay prosperous and vibrant and forward-looking? Our defense, who is going to man the SAF? Who will defend us? We can't be dad's army. Already we are seeing the impact of an aging population today. There are more sandwich families, typically 2 adults working, maybe 1.5 working adults, supporting children, supporting elderly parents. We are seeing greater demand for healthcare and social services. And I think whatever we do with our population, we're going to see aging as a serious trend for a long time to come. So we have to make sure that our aged elderly age well and live fulfilling lives, which means financially they must be well prepared for retirement with home ownership, with good health care provided for, with CPF, with silver support. It means they have to be socially active. We encourage active aging, strengthening community support. Come out, be active, do Tai Chi with your friends, meet your friends, play Mahjong even. It's good, exercises the brain. Make our homes friendly so that seniors can live safe, healthy, and fulfilling lives. So we have to take care of our old folks, take care of our aging, but ultimately the best and indeed the only fundamental solution for Singapore is for more Singaporeans to marry, and after they marry, to have more children. And that's a message to all of you too. And on that count, we have labored mightily, and I'm happy to say that if you look at last year's numbers, there's a little bit of good news, although it's still early signs yet. We've done many measures, and over the last 20 years, what we've done, I think, has helped. More affordable and accessible preschool places, more maternity leave, more pro-family employers, including the civil service becoming more pro-family. And if you look at the numbers, well, last year, the number of babies' marriages last year, 24,000, is the highest we've had since a very long time. So at least that's the first step. Get married, now we can think about having kids. Babies born last year, not bad. Not brilliant, but not bad. Why? Because last year we had 33,200. Not a dragon year, but equal to a dragon year. Of course, equal to a small dragon year, because 12 years ago, that's where we should be. But anyway, I count my blessings even if they are small ones. If you look at the TFR, well, we've been 1.2 plus, then it came down last year, 1.25. So this signal is ambiguous, but at any rate, it's not getting worse. And I think if we work hard, there's some chance of it going in this direction, better. So this is a fundamental issue. We talk about it lightly, we joke about it, but it's a fundamental issue. And we have to do more to help Singaporeans to get married, to have babies, to take care of their families. And baby bonuses help, but it's not just money. It's also the practical arrangements, the values, the attitudes, the social understandings which we reach, which help people to have kids. Helping young couples to get their house, helping parents with caregiving, promoting flexible work arrangements, providing affordable and high-quality health care, child care, reducing stress in our education system. These are things we have ideas on, and I think we will do more of progressively. But these are just policies, and the government cannot solve this problem just by policies, because it requires all of us to change our norms, our culture, for us to become a more family-friendly country. And that takes time. But that's why I say on a 10-year view, this is not critical. But on a 25-year view, we have to start now. And hopefully, in 25 years' time, we will be able to benefit from some of the results. But if you take a 50-year time frame, then I would say even more fundamental than demographics is the question of identity, of a sense of pride, of being Singaporean, of wanting to be Singaporean, of wanting Singapore to have a future. How do we strengthen this identity and the character of our nation and our society? How do we reinforce what makes us unique as Singaporeans, helps each of us to do well, and helps Singapore as a whole to do well? 50 years ago, when we became independent, we had nowhere else to go. And Mr. Lee Kuan Yew never tired of telling us, the world doesn't owe us a living. Fight for it. But because the challenges were great, because we had no choice, so we felt a sense of common purpose building this nation. That was the only way forward for us. And people were galvanized, including many who were not born here, but who made this their home and their cause. They made an act of will, a choice, and they said, Singapore is where I will make my home and build my future and my nation. And they did. And year after year, we had crises, we had successes, we grew closer together, and we strengthened our identity as Singaporeans. So for the next 50 years, how do we maintain this sense of nationhood and strengthen this identity and common purpose so that people, our people, will want to make Singapore a success and a shining light in the world? As we progress, there are two threats to this idea of a Singaporean identity. One, we could just dissolve, melt into a globalized world, and lose that special sense of being distinctive Singaporean, different from non-Singaporeans. The other risk is that we could divide internally along fault lines, fracture into different groups, and each group with its own exclusive identity, and lose any sense of becoming one people. We can dissolve with globalization. It's an opportunity for us, so many things we can do, but it's a threat to us if we don't hold together. Because we've become so open, so cosmopolitan, our people can adapt anywhere and be at home in many, many places in the world. Most of our people speak English, the young ones all the more so. Everybody today is educated in English. Most of our people have post-secondary education. More than half, probably more than two-thirds, many are graduates. With English, with good education, doors to Singaporeans open all over the world. And there are 200,000 of us, we think, living, working, or studying abroad in all kinds of different countries. You know people in Australia. Talking to Tony Abbott, they think there are more than 50,000 Singaporeans there. China, there must be large numbers. America, there must be large numbers. But I give you two very interesting examples. One person I know of, a Singaporean, lives in Rwanda, in Eastern Africa. What's he doing there? He keeps honeybees. He's a beekeeper. He grows honey. He farms it. And he exports it. And I got to know of him because I went to a restaurant here and they served me dessert with Rwandan honey made by the Singaporean in Rwanda. So I blogged about him on my Facebook and he got in touch with me and said, hello, says, next time I'll show you my honeybees. Because the Africans don't farm honey, they hunt honey. But he goes there, he farms it, he's made a living for himself. Another Singaporean I recently got to know of lives in Hokkaido, in Japan. I was there on holiday recently. I met busloads of Singaporeans. This chap I didn't meet. Well, it's nice to meet busloads of Singaporeans. Roomfuls even better. But this chap got in touch with me. He says, you don't know me, but I live and work in Niseko. Niseko is a ski resort, very good snow. A lot of Singaporeans go there. And this man is a full-time ski instructor, making a living, living in Niseko. He says, next time you come, I'll give you a lesson. So Singaporeans are all over, comfortable all over. They travel enormously. Every year, we make altogether about 9 million trips abroad by air and sea. That means, on average, more than 2 trips per resident. And that doesn't count 13 million trips to Malaysia. People going to Johor Bahru, shopping, or supper, or Genting. Any number. And in SMU, I was just talking to your chairman, 80-something percent of your students have opportunities to go overseas as part of your studying. I hope you're studying overseas. I've met some of you when I'm overseas, and they're very confident. Come up to me with aplomb and say, hello, I'm from SMU. I said, what are you doing here? The last group I met was in Italy. I said, you're studying in Italy? He says, no, I'm studying in Helsinki, but I came to Italy on holiday. I'm from SMU. So Singaporeans travel. I think it's marvelous. But at the same time, if we become so comfortable abroad that we lose the sense that only Singapore is truly home. As Dick Lee says, this is home truly. And if a large part of our talent goes overseas, either to seek challenges or to seek their fortunes, then I think we will be depleted. Our center cannot hold. It's one of the challenges which other countries have, small countries have. New Zealanders have a big population abroad. The Greeks have a big population abroad. The Irish have a big population abroad, and they have difficulty keeping the center together. The Greeks now in very serious difficulties. And if Singapore gets into that situation, I think we will have a problem. We will just melt away, dissolved by globalization. So we need to make sure that while we create all these opportunities overseas, Singaporeans still continue to feel that call of home deep in their hearts, and consider here, Singapore, our home. So that's one danger. We can melt away. But the other danger is that we can quarrel amongst ourselves and split along fault lines, become a divided society. It could be race and religion, our traditional fault lines. It could be new fault lines, LGBT issues, for and against. It could be social and political fault lines, rich versus poor. Or it could be external forces which pull us in different directions. Jihadist terrorism is one such factor. ISIS could cause a very serious schism in our society if one day we have a terrorist attack in Singapore. And it could split our multi-religious society. But even apart from ISIS, the influence of big powers can make a difference. We are still a multi-ethnic society, Chinese, Indians, Malays, others. Yes, we are all Singaporeans, but it will be a very long time before we can be immune either to the ethnic pulls on us or to the commercial interests of our business people working in these different countries, and therefore always open to being influenced, if not become dependent on those countries and on their interests rather than ours. So to keep Singapore special, to maintain that sense that I'm a Singaporean, I'm proud of it, and I want to uphold it, to feel a duty and a responsibility, not only to your fellow citizens today, but to the next generation, to feel one united people and not warring clans, I think in the very long term, that is our most fundamental challenge. So what is it which will hold us together, which will help us to strengthen our identity in the very long term? Well, the first thing which comes to mind for Singaporeans is food. Every time we are away, we think of chicken rice, char kway teow, roti prata. And yes, food definitely helps, but I think food is surely not fundamental. So it has to come from something deeper than that. A shared sense of what it is that Singapore stands for, what we want to achieve here together, and that comes from our shared experiences, our bonding through these shared experiences, becoming one people, becoming comrades, more than friends. It depends on how we grow up and live together in our schools, in our national service, in our HDB flats and estates. It depends on how we overcome crisis, whether it's SARS, whether it's MERS, whether there's a global financial crisis, dealing with the problems together. It depends on how we help one another in times of need, how we celebrate successes together, celebrate SG50, as we celebrate a good performance in the SEA Games. And through these shared experiences, we can live and reinforce the values which we share, which mark us out as Singaporeans. Meritocracy, multiracialism, justice and equality, fair and just society, full and equal opportunities for all. A place where the human spirit can thrive, can prosper, and tomorrow will always be brighter. And we will learn, I think, also through hard times. And I'm sure that in the next 50 years, there will be hard times, and we will be tested. But these tests, these crises, will be opportunities for us to bond. And we've experienced some of the Singapore spirit this year. When Mr. Lee Kuan Yew passed away in March, we grieved together. It was a massive outpouring of emotion, but we were not downcast. We stood firm, we queued up in the sun, we lined up in the rain, we paid our respects to our founding father. Recently, when we lost school children and teachers on a school adventure training trip, leadership training trip on Mount Kinabalu, we grieved together. We rejoiced during the SEA Games when we felt proud to be Singaporean. Not just winning 84 gold medals, but the way our people conducted ourselves when the music stopped when it shouldn't stop, and we knew how to sing Majula Singapura without the music. I think that's a moment of pride. When Ashley Liu, who is an SMU alumnus, showed class and sportsmanship. He was a marathoner. Early in the race, several of the others took the wrong turn. He found himself in the lead. He waited, gave chance, let them come back, resumed the race. He didn't win a medal. He finished eighth, but he said, it's not always about the medals. It's also the things you do in between. So you need that spirit, and it's a spirit which is not manufactured by the government. These are spontaneous shows of pride, of solidarity. It's a spirit which is embraced, which is created and owned by Singaporeans. People who stand up for these values in their daily lives, in their actions, and make this a distinctive nation that we are proud of and want to belong to. So that never mind where we are, we identify with it and we say, I am a Singaporean. I've spent some time talking to you about serious challenges which we look forward to. The economy, the population, our sense of identity. They concern our survival, but we're dealing with them. I think we have approaches. You don't have permanent solutions, but we have ways we can tackle them. For the economy, we have a strong team, whether in MTI, in EDB, in IE Singapore, or Spring. Securing investments, opening markets, helping SMEs, creating jobs. We have skills future, valuing a person less for the qualifications he has and more for his contributions and his potential. For the population, we are managing immigration issues. They're sensitive, but we are watching them very closely. We are promoting active aging. And we are strongly encouraging marriage and parenthood. In case you didn't hear this message just now, I'm telling you again. For our national identity, we nurture values and common experiences in our schools, through our NS, even the new volunteer corps. And we use SG50 and other opportunities, not just to celebrate, but to deepen our sense of being Singaporeans. And besides everything which we do, I think life will teach us lessons. Difficult times will come, and through them we will learn what it means to be a Singaporean, whether we like it or not. But all these things we want to do depend on good leadership. Leadership at all levels, but leadership also for the nation. We need leaders with a sense of responsibility, wholly committed to Singapore and to Singaporeans. Leaders who can win your support and rally the country together. Leaders who can work with us and make the next 50 years as glorious as the last 50 years. And then, not only will our next generation enjoy a good life, but they will be able to look forward to a brighter future for themselves and for their children. Thank you very much.